All right, so we're talking about the application of quadratics today. You guys are going to be able to model different situations with quadratic equations. That could be anything from someone is tossing the ball and how long does it take for the ball to hit the ground, or you have a farmer who's trying to build a fence and he wants to have a certain maximum area with a certain amount of fence. You know, example problems like that, okay? And the thing is that you want to be able to, if you're not given the equation, you're going to have to use some of the concepts from your geometry days to set up some of these problems, okay? Such as, what is the formula for the area of a square or a rectangle? The formula to find the area of a rectangle. Base times height or length times width. What about to find the perimeter of a rectangle? Length times 2 plus width times 2, okay? What about the area of the circle? It is pi r squared. You're trying to give me circumference. What's circumference? 2 pi r. You may also have to deal with volume or surface area of a shape as well. I do believe volume formulas are in your reference booklet. The surface area is basically area of all your faces, the outside of the surface. Okay? So some of these, if they don't give you the equation, then you're going to have to use some of your knowledge of those geometric shapes in order to do this. Okay? So pretty much all today is examples. Okay? Because we've done everything that's led up to this point. We've learned how to solve a quadratic. We've determined how to find the vertex. Okay? Now it's just going to be a matter of applying those things to these particular problems. Okay? So I'll give you about 2 minutes to write this down, and then we're going to go over it. All right, so we have a farmer wishes to enclose a rectangular garden with 100 meters of fencing. If the garden is X meters wide, find the length and the area of the garden in terms of X. Find the width of the garden with an area of 525 meters squared, and then find the maximum area that the garden can have. Okay? So this first sentence basically sets it up for you. Gives you everything that you need to know. A farmer wishes to enclose a rectangular garden. Okay, so we have a rectangular garden. I'm going to draw my rectangle. And they have 100 meters of fencing. Everybody knows what fencing is, correct? It's stuff that goes around this area, aka the perimeter. Okay, so we know that the perimeter of this garden is 100 meters. So, what's the formula again that goes with perimeter of a rectangle? Two length plus two width. So that has to equal P. That has to equal 100. So we know that, okay? And so let's go ahead and let's label this rectangle. We have two L's and two W's. Right? Now it says if the garden is X meters wide, dang heaven, okay. So I have to change my W to what? X. I have to find my length, okay? So since it's X meters wide, let's go ahead and change this actually to X, which means let's go ahead and let's change L as well. What should L be? Y. Because it wants to give us X and Y. We have to find the length of the garden and the area of the garden in terms of X, okay? Remember, whenever it says in terms of X, that means it should be Y equals blah, 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 X, okay? So, how do you find the length? What do you think you can do here to find the length? Solve for Y in what equation? Which equation? In which equation? The perimeter equation. The only equation that we have on the screen right now, correct? Okay, so we need to solve for y in the perimeter equation. Okay? So go ahead and solve for y. That means you have to get y by itself. make sure you reduce so we can deal with some smaller numbers. What does y equal? 50 minus x. Because we're going to subtract over the 2x and then we'll divide every term by 2. So here is the formula for the length. Okay, so this is length. And now we have to find the area of the garden in terms of x. What's the formula for area again? Base times height or length times width, okay? Well, length is y and width is x. But is this area formula in terms of x? No. We have a y as well there. What can I do to get rid of that y? Plug in for what we found for y previously. So if I plug in 50 minus x in for y, I'll get this. Can I simplify this? Distribute. What does that give me? Negative x squared plus 50x. And what does that look like to you guys? A quadratic. Exactly. Okay? So here we go. Here are our answers to part A. The formula for the area and then the formula for our length. Now it says find the width of the garden with an area of 525 meters squared. Well, if I'm looking for my width, that means I'm looking for what variable? X. And then it says my area is 525. So where can I plug in that 525? For the area, for the A. So I'm going to have 525 equals a negative x squared plus 50x. And now I'm going to have to solve for x. How do I solve a quadratic? Factoring or quadratic formula or completing the square. I probably would suggest that if you're doing these types of problems, don't complete the square. It's probably the one that has like the most work involved at all, okay? So try either factoring or quadratic formulas first before you even try to complete the square, all right? But in order to use either of those methods, can I start from here or do I have to do something else? Huh? I need to take out the negative, but what else do I need to do? Get it to the other side. I gotta get it in the standard form, okay? Me personally, I prefer working with my x squared is positive. That's just me. And so I decided to add x squared over and subtract 50x. Okay? Go ahead and solve this. Nope, this is a non-calculator problem. I'll let you know which ones are calculator, okay? Solve this. Was this factorable? Or did you use quadratic formula? I hope you didn't use quadratic formula. It was factorable. What two numbers multiply to give you 525 that adds to give you negative 50? Twenty-five actually give me 625. So not quite. Still need a little more time? One more time. What is it? So negative 35 and negative 15, because they both have to be negative in order to make a negative 50. So what's the value of x? 35 and 15. Already out of space. Okay? So the width of the garden that can produce an area of 525 can either be 35 meters long or 15 meters long. Okay? Now it's asking us, new problem, it's asking us to find the maximum area the garden can have. Maximum area signifies what concept of a quadratic? maximum area, we're looking for that highest point, aka vertex. Okay? So you have to find the maximum area. That's not the entire vertex, it's only a part of the vertex. Is that the x coordinate or is that the y coordinate? It's the y coordinate. Okay? So the maximum area the garden can have is the y coordinate of the vertex. And I go straight to finding the y coordinate, or do I have to find something else before I can get there? Got to find the x coordinate, okay? Got to find the x coordinate. So, how do I find the x coordinate? Axis symmetry, negative b over 2a. Okay? Negative b over 2a. So, negative b over 2a. What's the b in our problem? Positive or negative?
Negative.
So it's negative 50? Okay. And then what's a?
Negative
1. So what's negative 50 divided by negative 2? 25. So this represents the x-coordinate. So basically, to get a maximum area for this particular situation we're dealing with, the width would have had to been 25 meters long. It didn't ask us to find that, but just in case it did, we would know what it is. Now, how do I find the actual maximum area? What do I do? Plug it into the original equation for the area. The maximum area, which makes sense because a rectangle, the only way you can get a maximum area is a square. There you go. Application problem one down. Here's the next one. This one is calculator. This one is calculator. So the height of a ball t seconds after it is thrown is modeled by the function h equals 24 t. Minus 4.9 t squared plus 1, where h is the height of the ball in meters. T clearly represents what? Time. Okay? So, it's saying to find the maximum height reached by the ball. Maximum height means what? The y coordinate of the vertex. Okay? We have to find the y coordinate of the vertex. In order to find the y coordinate, we need the what? The x. So, x coordinate is negative b over 2a. What's b? So it's going to be a minus 24. What's a? So we're going to figure this out. We are allowed to use our calculator. So we're going to do negative 24 divided by whatever 2 times negative 4.9 is. What's that number? Type it in, the calculator knows you are dividing it by negative 9.8. Okay? But we are trying to find the maximum height of the ball, which means we actually need to take this value that's still stored in our calculator and plug it into the original. Now, and this is where, like, we have this issue a lot of times, especially with SL students, is that, I mean, say that you define the x-coordinate, and you found it, you rounded it, three significant figures, great, but then you have to use it to answer that next question. A lot of students use the rounded answer. Refrain from doing that. You already have the non-rounded answer in your calculator. Just continue to use that as you plug it into the original equation. The easiest way to do it is by pressing the second button and then the negative button. That basically takes your previous answer and brings it down to the next line. So when we're plugging this in, you know, we'll type 24 times second negative, and it basically pull that entire decimal down. Okay? Minus 4.9 second negative squared plus 1. Some of you guys do have the luxury of going up and just pulling it down, but not every calculator does that. For example, minus 1. Some of the yellow ones don't do that as well either. What you guys get for your maximum height? And that's the answer that you round. That's our final answer. Did everyone get 30.4? So now for part B, it's asked us for what length of time will the ball be higher than 20 meters? What are we looking for in this problem? AKA what variable? T, technically. Okay? So we're looking for T. So that means what are we going to plug 20 into? How you get your method points? By letting the grader know that for part B, I know I'm looking to see where this equation equals 20. This is how you can get that method point. I mean, essentially, we're going to use our calculator to solve this, but this is how you can get those method points, just in case you type something wrong into your calculator. Now, yes, you could solve this using quadratic form, okay? There's nothing wrong with doing that. You can. However, there is another way to do this, okay? And that is using your calculator. Now, last year I had a program that allowed me to show the calculator along with you guys so you can follow along, but I do not have that anymore. And my license expired. So I'm going to explain it to you, so I'm hoping that you guys are able to follow along. All right? Graph this. Type y equals. That button is located in the top left corner. You have all these options for y1, y2, y3, correct? What you want to do is you want to basically type in 20. For y1, and then the whole right side into y2. So 20, enter, and then 24. You're not going to be able to use the variable t, but that's just our independent variable, so we're going to use x. That button is located right beside the alpha button. Again, don't try to go in there and pull out a t, a lowercase t, or a capital T. Use the variable x. That's the only way that you're going to be able to solve this problem. Y equals, and then you're going to type these two equations, so y1 and y2. So, has anyone got that in? Awesome. So now that we've graphed it, we see a line, a horizontal line represents 20, and we see our quadratic as well. We want to know where those two curves intersect each other. So we have this quadratic, we have this line, we're looking for this value here and this value here. For those who don't know, you press the second button, and then you press the trace button. Second button, and then trace. And then there's an option that says intersect. Option 5. Intersect allows you to basically figure out, the calculator figures out where those two curves intersect with each other. Okay? So you'll click intersect, and then on your graph will say first curve, correct? You want to move that flashing cursor closer to the first intersection point. Okay? And you do that by using the left arrow and the right arrow. Now you want to get it close to that x value, or close to that intersection point, and and you'll click enter once, enter twice, and then enter one last time. And then it'll give you the intersection point. And we're concerned about that x value. What's that x value? Enter three times once I'm closer to that other intersection point. Enter, enter, enter. What do we get? We need to know the difference in between. So I have to take those two numbers and do what to them now? Subtract them. So I'm going to go to my home screen, my favorite button, second mode. Second mode quits any application you're in. Okay? So second mode takes you back to the home screen. I'm going to type in these series of decimals, and then I'm going to round that final answer. How long? 2.917.
Why didn't we go ahead and just take the full decimal?
We could. I don't know if your calculator does it, but my old school TI-83 Plus doesn't allow me to take the decimals from the graph and put them into the home screen. So that's why I wrote down four places just so I knew that. One more. Okay. So, it takes Lisa 3 hours to ride her bicycle up a hill and back down. Her average riding speed down the hill is 35 kilometers per hour faster than her average speed riding up the hill. If the distance from the bottom to the top of the hill is 40 kilometers, find Lisa's average uphill and downhill speeds. Okay? So, our variable. What formula are we going to use to create this equation? What formula do you know that deals with speed? Yes, ma'am. Yes, old school SAT tested formula of distance equals speed times time, or rate times time. Have you ever gotten about that from your younger years? This, I promise you, every SAT has at least one question that involves this point. Okay? So if you ever forgot about it, there's your refresher. Okay? Now, I'm looking for my speed, so I probably need to solve.
Teacher's trying to interrupt your answer.
All right. So, how do I solve for this? Wait. Solve for S here in this equation. Divide by T. We need to figure out what is the formula that I'm going to use for speed in order to set up the equation for this particular situation, okay? Now, this girl, she's riding her bike, correct? What is her distance? I hear 40 kilometers, I hear 80 kilometers, okay? Okay, well, hold on here. What does the 80 kilometers represent?
Up
and down. Is she going the same speed up and down? No. So we're going to have to look at these separately. We got to look at her uphill speed and her downhill speed and do kilometers, okay? And the time, how long does it take for her to go uphill?
3 hours
for both. So do we know how long it took her to go uphill?
35.
That's the one thing we don't know, correct? So even though we really don't know her speed, we definitely don't know how long it took her to do this. So that's actually our variable there. So we're going to plug in X for her time. We do not know how long it took her, but if we did, we could figure out how fast she was going uphill by plugging in that time, and then how fast she was going downhill. Does that make sense? So there's the equation for her going uphill. That's her uphill speed. What's her downhill speed? What's her distance downhill? 40 kilometers. That represents her going downhill. Okay? So together that's going to represent 3, correct? And we're only going to figure that out by figuring out, you know, exactly how fast she's going. So yes, common denominator, because we're dealing with a rational equation. Do you guys add these two first and get, like, that one fraction equals 3? Or do you, like, multiply everything by the common denominator? What is the common denominator? X squared plus 35x? Okay. We get the x squared plus 35x because we're doing x times x plus 35. So x times x plus 35. X times x plus 35. So when I multiply here, what is the numerator going to become now?
Teachers and students.
So what do we get?
So 40x squared plus 1,000 equals to x.
All over x, right? Okay. So I'm going to go ahead and simplify that down to be 40x plus 1,400. Because technically, yes, it would have been 40x squared plus 1,400x, but since everything's being divided by an x, you cancel those out. Plus what? 40x. And the last part will be, I'm actually going to put on this side to have more space. 3x squared plus 105. Solve this quadratic. We need to figure out x. Solve this quadratic. And now, get everything to one side, and this is a calculator problem, so we use the calculator. Or if you want to use it. Sorry guys, I missed that X because it was covered up by the thing. This will make a difference. It should be 105X. in the standard form could help if you've been stuck struggling. Okay, and you can still use your calculator here to do this. Plug in the left side into y1, 0 into y2. Clearly, y equals 0 is the what? It's y equals 0. Your x-axis. Okay, you can use the intersect feature doing that as well. Okay? So you plug in the left side into y1, the right side into y2, and you would end up getting x equals 17.8 as your positive value, and then you would have got another one that would have been a negative value. Like your quadratic hit like this. And since we are talking about like x, this is representing the time, you can't have a negative time. So we're not concerned about this one, we're concerned about that one, which is 17.8. So x equals 17.8, so that means x plus 35 equals 52.8. And these are kilometers per hour. So those would be the times it took her to go uphill and then downhill. So then to actually find her speed uphill would have been 40 divided by the 17.8 so-and-so number. And then her speed downhill would have been 40 divided by this 52.8. So on and so forth number. Okay? So it's like 17.8339. So I'm gonna plug that in. And so our average speed was about 2.24 kilometers per hour to go uphill, and then to go downhill was about 0.757 kilometers per hour. And I'm sorry, you guys, I messed up with my units back up here. These two are my final answers. But my units back up here would just been that would just been the